Hello students, welcome back. Now in this lecture we will see one of the important aspects of the renal system, that is filtration. Where does this filtration occur? This filtration will occur here at the glomerulus. This is the figure of the glomerulus. This is the afferent arteriole. This is the glomerular capillaries, network of the glomerular capillaries. And this is the efferent arteriole. Blood will be delivered in the glomerular capillaries with the high pressure, high hydrostatic pressure. So ultimately what will happen? The filtrate will be formed here. That means some of the fluid, that is plasma minus plasma proteins, that will be filtered here. And that is the rest of the blood which is not filtered, that will pass to the efferent arteriole. This is filtration. This filtrate now, this is the Bowman's capsule. Now, this filtrate will pass from the Bowman's capsule, then it will go to the PCT, DCT, loop of Henle, and it will go to the DCT and the collecting duct where the filtrate can be modified. And ultimately, the urine will be formed. So, we will be seeing about the filtration. The concept of GFR, that is glomerular filtration rate, this should be very clear. What is glomerular filtration rate? What is its definition? It is the amount of filtrate formed by all the nephrons of both the kidneys in a unit time. What is the definition of glomerular filtration rate? The amount of filtrate formed by all the nephrons of both the kidneys in a unit time. This is called as GFR or glomerular filtration rate. The normal value of the GFR is 125 ml per minute, or it is 180 liters per day. Normally, how much amount of the plasma that is filtered here? Suppose 100 ml of the plasma is flowing per minute. So out of 100 ml, 20 ml that will be filtered, and rest 80 ml that will be passing to the glomerular filtrate. So this is called as filtration fraction, which depends upon, that is, the amount of filtrate formed divided by the renal plasma flow, not the blood flow, but the renal plasma flow. That will be called as filtration fraction. So that is about 20%, that is the filtration fraction. What is the composition of the filtrate formed here? Remember, it is similar to that of plasma, except it will not have plasma proteins. Plasma proteins will not be filtered. We will see why they will not be filtered. And the next, whatever the substances which are bound to the plasma proteins, such as some of the hormones, they are being carried by the plasma proteins. So, these substances bound with the plasma protein, they will not be present here. So, apart from that, all the rest of the content will be similar to that of the plasma. So, that is the content. So, what is the composition of the glomerular filtrate? Plasma minus plasma protein minus substances bound to the plasma protein. Now, let's go into the detailed structure of the glomerular capillary membrane. That means one which is mainly going to do the filtration. Because any disturbance or in a histological disturbance, pathology, any pathology which is causing disturbance of this glomerular capillary membrane will naturally going to affect the filtration, and it will disturb the function of the kidney. So this is the histological structure of the glomerular capillary membrane. As you can see here, these are the capillary. This is the capillary, this is the basement membrane, and this is the layer of the Bowman's capsule. That is there. Now what you can see here, this look at the structure of the capillary. The capillaries are equipped with, or they are having number of fenestrae. The fenestrae, large opening are there. This is important to cause large amount of the filtration, right? But this fenestrae here, these are lined, this opening, these are lined by the negative charge. These are lined by the negative charge. Now, what is the importance of this negative charge? Remember, the size of the fenestrae is much more compared to that the size of the albumin. The albumin should be easily filtered through this fenestrae. But albumin, a plasma protein, again it is a negatively charged. This fenestrae will be lined by the negatively charged. So, negative-negative will repel. And this is the main reason why albumin is not being filtered. There are a number of disease conditions in which the negative charge is disturbed of the glomerular capillary membrane, and in that case, albumin can be easily filtered, right? Next, coming to the basement membrane. This basement membrane is again made up of meshwork of collagen and proteoglycans. This proteoglycans, again, these are negatively charged. And now you understand the importance of negative charge to repel the negatively charged proteins. The layer of this Bowman's capsule, this is mainly formed by the cells which are called as podocytes. Podocytes means what? The podo means the legs. So they will throw out the legs. Podocytes are there. They will surround and they will throw out the legs as such. And in between these podocytes, there is a gap. This is called as slit pores. Again, that is the one to slit pores are present to facilitate large amount of filtration. Again, these slit pores, they are lined by the negative charge to repel the negatively charged proteins. So the glomerular capillary membrane, it is made up of capillary endothelium, basement membrane and the podocytes. What are the factors which are determining the GFR? This is a commonly asked question. What are the factors determining GFR? Number of factors are there. First, you have to understand what is the net filtration pressure. Now, let's look at the equation here. The net filtration pressure will be equal to glomerular hydrostatic pressure. As we have seen here, the glomerular hydrostatic pressure is quite high, which is 60 mm of Hg. High pressure it is delivered to that. Minus Bowman's capsule pressure, the pressure in the Bowman's capsule, hydrostatic pressure, will try to repel the filtration or oppose the filtration. So minus Bowman's capsule pressure, minus glomerular oncotic pressure, glomerular sum of the plasma proteins, if at all they are filtered here, this, if at all, glomerular capillary oncotic pressure, that means the minus glomerular oncotic pressure, that means if the plasma proteins which are present in the glomerular capillaries, they will be opposing the filtration, right? So what is my net filtration pressure then equal to? Net filtration pressure will become 10 mm of Hg, which is according to the equation, glomerular hydrostatic pressure is 60 mm of Hg subtracted by the Bowman's capsule hydrostatic pressure, that is 18 mm of Hg subtracted by glomerular oncotic pressure, which is 32 mm of Hg. Normally, there are no plasma proteins here, so we do not consider the oncotic pressure of the glomerular, that is the filtrate which is being formed here. The glomerular capillary filtration coefficient, that is equal to the GFR upon the net filtration pressure, that is how much amount of the filtrate is being formed for per unit of the net filtration pressure, that is equal to the glomerular capillary filtration coefficient. What are the factors which determine the GFR? The glomerular capillary filtration coefficient depends upon the surface area. Larger the surface area, more will be the filtration. This becomes important factor in case of some disease conditions in which some of the glomerulus get damages and the surface area that will get decreased. Or if there is a loss of nephrons, then the surface area will decrease and in that case the filtrate that will be formed will be less. Thickness. Thickness of the glomerular capillary membrane. Now if it becomes more thick, in that case the filtrate will be formed with more difficulty. That means what is going to happen with the GFR? GFR is going to be decreased. This glomerular capillary membrane will become thick in certain conditions such as diabetes mellitus and chronic hypertension. Remember these two conditions. Diabetes and hypertension remains most important. 70% of the cases of the renal failure are because of the diabetes and hypertension. And where they are going to act most? Well, they are going to act over the glomerular capillary membrane. So this can be a favorite multiple choice question. Which are the common causes of the renal failure? So, diabetes and the hypertension, they contribute to the maximum. Then, in some of the disease condition, the size of this pores, that can be disturbed, or even the charge lining them, that can be disturbed. So, if the negative charge is removed from that, albumin, they can be easily filtered. So, this happens in nephrotic syndrome, right? Even RBCs, they can be filtered, if at all, in some disease condition, nephrotic condition. So hematuria will occur in that case. So these are the factors which increase in Bowman's capsule hydrostatic pressure. So if at all the Bowman's capsule hydrostatic pressure. Now this hydrostatic pressure, when it can increase? Suppose there is a renal stone, a stone blocking let's say in the ureter. It will cause backward pressure. That backward pressure ultimately will be traveled and it will be increase the hydrostatic pressure, or even if there is a renal stones, ultimately they will cause the backward pressure and the hydrostatic pressure here in the Bowman's capsule that will increase. In this case, what will happen to the GFR? Naturally, less amount of the filtrate that will be formed and GFR will decrease. Because of that, the condition, the backward pressure, it can cause hydronephrosis. Increase in glomerular capillary colloid osmotic pressure. Now, if the plasma protein content in this glomerular capillary, if it is increased, now this oncotic pressure will oppose the filtration. So, in that case, the GFR will decrease. In which conditions this can happen? This can happen in case of dehydration. So, where the fluid content of the plasma will be less, so the plasma protein content that will be increased, and the GFR in that case that will be decreased. In case of dehydration, this can occur. Increased glomerular capillary hydrostatic pressure, that is going to increase the GFR. Suppose this pressure is going to increase, the afferent artery will dilate. Now what will happen? The capillary hydrostatic pressure that will increase, and in that case the filtration is going to be increased. What are the conditions in this can happen? Increase in arterial pressure, afferent arteriole dilatation, as we are seeing here. Moderate efferent arteriole constriction. Now, if I constrict now, you have to remember these things. The glomerular capillaries, they are lie between afferent and the efferent arteriole. Now, suppose this is the afferent arteriole, this is the efferent arteriole. If I dilate the afferent arteriole, the more amount of the fluid will flow in the glomerular capillaries, the pressure in them, it will increase and the filtration can increase. Now, if I keep this stable and if I constrict the efferent arteriole, now what will happen? The pressure in the glomerular capillaries, again it will increase and the filtrate that can be formed, that will be more. So, I can increase the GFR by two conditions. I can dilate the afferent arteriole or I can constrict moderately the efferent arteriole. But remember, constriction of the efferent arteriole more than that, severe constriction will in fact decrease the GFR. Now, how it is going to decrease the GFR? It will decrease the GFR because of two cases. If there is a severe constriction now, because of more filtrate is being formed, the plasma protein content will increase in the glomerular capillaries. Once this plasma protein content will increase, they will oppose the filtration. So, the GFR is going to decrease. Not only that, but whatever the blood which is leaving the efferent arteriole, that will be less. That means less blood in the peritubular capillaries. If there is less blood in the peritubular capillaries, what will happen? More absorption. So, it will favor more absorption. So, severe constriction will have the opposite effect. It will going to reduce the GFR. Other factors which are affecting the GFR, sympathetic stimulation, epinephrine, norepinephrine, endothelin, which will cause the afferent arteriole constriction. It will decrease the blood flow, decrease the pressure in the glomerular capillaries, and it will decrease the GFR. Angiotensin II. Now, this is a very important hormone which will regulate the GFR. This is the hormone which is released in case where there is a blood decrease in the blood volume. If there is a decrease in the blood volume, there are the two things which can happen. Decrease in blood volume, decrease in the afferent arteriole, that is the blood flow, decrease in the glomerular capillary, blood flow, and ultimately the GFR should decrease. But then the challenge in front of the body is that if the GFR decreases severely, in that case what will happen? The amount of filtrate form will not be sufficient. The blood will not get sufficiently purified in a sense. So how the body overcomes then that? The angiotensin II is released. Because of the juxtaglomerular apparatus, we will see that. The renin angiotensin mechanism. This angiotensin II is a potent vasoconstrictor. But some of the vessels, they escape from the vasoconstrictor effect of that. And one important vessel is the afferent arteriole. The afferent arteriole is not sensitized to the constrictor effect of the angiotensin II. But the efferent arteriole will get constricted. So what if the afferent arteriole is not getting constricted, what will happen to the GFR? The GFR will not decrease much. But if the efferent arteriole get constricted, the GFR can, the pressure in the glomerular capillaries will be maintained and the GFR can be maintained. At the same time, the filtrate is being formed. Once the filtrate is being formed, the nephron can modify it. Whatever the metabolic waste product, it can be removed. But the challenge in front of the body is that there is a decreased blood volume. So, therefore, the body wants to conserve the blood. That is, conserve the fluid. So, how the body will try to conserve the fluid? Whenever there is an efferent arteriole constriction now, the amount of fluid flowing to the peritubular capillaries, that will be less. The hydrostatic pressure in the peritubular capillaries, that will be less. So, the amount of absorption will be more. So, what the nephron will do? Whatever the metabolic waste products, they will be excreted out. It will not be absorbed, but the fluid will be absorbed much more by the peritubular capillaries. So in that case, the metabolic waste products, they are also excreted. At the same time, the fluid is getting conserved. So this is a magic that is done by the angiotensin second. And this is how it will auto-regulate the GFR. And this is very important hormone whenever there is a severe case of the decrease in the blood volume. Certain vasodilators such as nitric oxide, prostaglandins and bradykinin, they tend to increase the GFR because they will vasodilate, afferent arterioles will get dilated, more blood fluid flow in the glomerular capillaries. High protein diet, excess glucose will increase the GFR. Now the high protein diet, how does it cause an increase in the GFR? One of the hypotheses that suggested that if there is a high protein diet, that means more proteins in the afferent arteriole, more proteins in the capillaries. At least they should decrease the GFR. But you have to remember that more proteins will also flow in the peritubular capillaries. So if there is more proteins in the peritubular capillaries, they will have the oncotic effect and they will cause the absorption of the fluid. So ultimately, it is going to cause the more absorption. Excess of glucose will also, along with the glucose, glucose cannot be absorbed unless and until sodium is being absorbed. So the glucose and sodium absorption and the sodium and the protein absorption, that is taking place together with the symporters. So if the sodium is being absorbed, even the water is also being absorbed along with that. So the absorption will be increased mainly because of the high protein diet and the excess glucose which is there. So we can see some conditions which will decreasing the GFR. As you can see in this table, renal diseases, which is going to damage the glomerular capillary membrane, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, which is going to cause thickening of the glomerular capillary membrane, it will decrease the filtration fraction as such. Urinary tract obstruction, example in the kidney stone, they will cause the backward pressure, increase in the hydrostatic pressure of the Bowman's capsule, and it is going to decrease the GFR. Decrease in the renal blood flow, increased plasma protein, it will going to decrease the GFR because increased glomerular capillary colloid oncotic pressure. Decrease angiotensin second, drugs that block angiotensin second formation. So which some of the drugs which are there. This will mainly cause afferent arteriole dilation, and in that case they are going to increase the GFR in that case. Increase sympathetic activity or vasoconstrictor hormones, norepinephrine or endothelin, they will cause afferent arterial constriction, and in that case they are going to decrease the GFR. Decrease in renal blood flow, decrease in glomerular capillary hydrostatic pressure, and that is going to decrease the GFR. Right? So in this case, except this, so as we have seen in this case, decrease drugs that block angiotensin second formation, that is going to increase the GFR. Apart from that, the rest of the parameters, they will decrease the GFR. Now, auto-regulation of the GFR. As we have seen that the kidneys can auto-regulate the blood flow. The main important thing the kidneys wants that the GFR should be auto-regulated, because unless and until the filtrate is being formed, the excretion of the metabolic waste products, it will not be sufficient. So the GFR can be auto-regulated between the blood pressure of 80 to 170 mmHg. So that is going to cause. Importance of the auto-regulation. If there is an increase in blood pressure, increase in blood pressure will increase the GFR tremendously. And if there is an increase in GFR, the filtrate will form very rapidly, flow will very rapidly through the nephron. If the filtrate is flowing very rapidly through the nephron will not have sufficient time for the absorption. So the lot of urine will be formed in case of hypertension. And in case of hypertension, reverse will happen. The very less amount of the urine will be formed and the metabolic waste products will not be excreted. So to prevent this fluctuations, there should be an importance of the auto-regulation. Right? There is another phenomena which is called as tubulo-glomerular balance. Now this can be asked as a multiple choice question. What is tubulo-glomerular balance? If at all more amount of the filtrate is formed, unless and until the reabsorption is increased, that filtrate will be excreted to the urine and a lot of fluid will be lost. So if more amount of the filtrate is formed, the nephron will increase its reabsorptive capacity. Suppose a perfect percentage of the electrolytes, they are always being absorbed by PCT. Let's say 65% of the most of the filtrate that are there, they are absorbed by the PCT. So even if the filtrate form is more, 65%, that means the perfect percentage that will be absorbed. So if there is more filtrate is being formed, absorption capacity of the nephron will increase and there will be more absorption in proportion to that. This is called as tubulo-glomerular balance. That means tubule will exactly balance the glomerular function. If the glomerular function has increased the filtrate, the tubules will increase the absorption rate. Now, one of the important mechanisms by which the autoregulation can happen is because of the renin-angiotensin system or the juxtaglomerular complex, that is the through the JGA. Now, as you have, if you recall the anatomy of the nephron, the PCT, proximal conduit tubule, then the loop of Henle, and a part of the DCT that will be passes through between the afferent and the efferent arteriole. These three structures together, these are called as juxtaglomerular apparatus. Now, these are called as the, what are the type of cells these are present? The DCT will have special type of cell which are in connection with the juxtaglomerular apparatus. These are called as macula densa cell. So, what is the name of these cells? Macula densa cells. Whereas the special type of cells which are present in connection with the juxtaglomerular apparatus, these are called as juxtaglomerular cells. What is the function of the macula densa cells? Macula densa cells, they can smell or they can analyze the concentration of the sodium. What is the function of the juxtaglomerular cells? They can synthesize renin. They can cause release of the renin. Now, the function of the juxtaglomerular apparatus, I can explain it with the example. Let's say that the person is suffering from the hypovolemia. So what will happen? Less amount of the fluid, less amount of the blood that will go to the efferent arteriole. Because of that, the pressure, hydrostatic pressure in the glomerular capillaries, that will decrease. If that is decreased, the GFR will decrease. GFR means less amount of the filtrate is being formed. And the rate of flow of the filtrate, that will decrease. Now, what these tubular cells they are lined by? These tubular cells they are lined by number of channels, mainly let's say sodium channels. Now, filtrate is moving through the tubule. When the filtrate is moving to the tubule, these channels they are continuously active. Channels present on these cells, they are causing absorption of the sodium chloride continuously. If the movement of the filtrate becomes slow, such as in case of hypovolemia, these channels are continuously active. So what will happen? More amount of sodium chloride will be absorbed. And this absorption will continue. This filtrate will go to the PCT, it will go to the loop of Henle, it will go to the DCT, and the initial portion of the DCT is the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Now, whenever the filtrate reaches here, since more amount of the sodium chloride has been absorbed by the tubular cells here, less sodium will reach to the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Now, what these macula densa cells, they sense? They sense the concentration of the sodium in the filtrate. So, the concentration of the sodium in the filtrate will be less. And now, they will send signals to the juxtaglomerular cells. And what the juxtaglomerular cells will release? They will release renin. And renin will convert angiotensin nogen into angiotensin 1. So what the angiotensinogen is present in the blood, it will be converted into angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 will be converted to angiotensin 2 by angiotensin converting enzyme. This enzyme is present in the endothelium of the lungs mainly or at the other places. So now this angiotensin 2, once it is being formed, angiotensin 2 has got four important effects. It will cause release of aldosterone, which is going to cause more sodium chloride to be absorbed. Along with that, water is also being absorbed and the blood volume is going to increase. Number second, angiotensin second will stimulate thirst, so that person will drink more fluid and the amount of blood volume that can be increased. Then angiotensin second is a potent vasoconstrictor. That means it is going to cause constriction except the afferent arteriole. So, potent vasoconstriction, if the efferent arteriole is constricted, the GFR can be maintained and the more absorption that can even occur, which I explained earlier. Not only that, but the vasoconstriction will increase the blood pressure. In hypovolemia, the blood pressure is going on falling down. And the last, the angiotensin second will cause release of ADH, that is antidiuretic hormone, vasopressin, which is going to cause more absorption of the fluid, and because of that, there is a more blood volume that is going to be increased. So because of all these four effects, now angiotensin second will try to maintain the blood pressure and it is trying to increase the blood volume. And in that effect, it also maintains or auto-regulates the GFR by causing vasoconstriction of the efferent arteriole, right? So here we end with the lecture of the, that is the filtration and the factors affecting the GFR. In the next, we will see about the reabsorption. Thank you.